What's up, you guys? Hope you're having an awesome day. I'm your host, Eamon Hassan, and welcome back to another video. Ah, Valentine's Day is upon us, you guys. I know for a lot of people, it's a day you're really looking forward to with your loved one, and for others, it's a day that makes you feel forever alone, and you're just like, can I not see another couple in my line of vision for the next year? Thank you. Well, regardless of which side you fall on, I think everyone will be able to come together for this one. These are the top 10 scariest things that happened on Valentine's Day. Starting us off at number 10 is the Rundle family. Valentine's Day 1985. 37-year-old Cassandra Rundle and her two kids, Detrick and Melanie, are the main characters of this gruesome story. That morning, Cassandra's second ex-husband showed up to her house to give her a record album as a gift, but when he entered the house, he found the entire family brutally murdered. Cassandra herself was found naked and tied up in bed. It was clear she had been raped, beaten, and then strangled to death. Melanie was found in the exact same condition in her own room, and Detrick was beaten to death in his own room where the murder weapon was found as well. It was a hockey stick. Despite a triple homicide being a massive deal, the culprit was never caught, and so the case simply went cold. Coming in at number 9 is China Rose Sims, Valentine's Day 1993. In February of 1988, David Sims got married to China Rose, a Filipino native who was 20 years his junior, whilst on a business trip to the country. The couple traveled back to England, moved in together, but the marriage quickly started falling apart, and China told her sister she desperately wanted to leave David since he had started violently abusing her. David had apparently even told her he'd kill her since it was cheaper than divorcing her. Fast forward to V-Day 1993, China went to a family event, and that was the last time she was ever seen alive. Despite telling her family she wanted to go home to the Philippines, she never contacted any of them again, and even more weird was the fact that David also dropped off the map too at the same time. David even had two daughters from a previous marriage that he cut off contact with as well, so till this day, we have no idea where China or David are, if David killed her, if she's even alive, absolutely nothing. At number 8, we have the date. Valentine's Day 2000. This one's from an anonymous Redditor who shared that she decided to go on a blind date on Valentine's Day that year, as she had been alone for a few years, so she was like, you know what, why not? What's a better time than now? They decided to go for a dinner date, and honestly, it was going well. The boy was attractive, he was funny, but for some reason he looked anxious or nervous, like he had to be somewhere else. The user brushed it off and proceeded to go over to his house for some wine, but things went horribly wrong. The duo started making out on the couch, and 30 seconds later, the guy had managed to somehow handcuff her to the window bar above them, non-consensually. He then told her he would only set her free if she performed certain sexual acts, and terrified, she agreed. He eventually let her go, and she called the police on him, but when they went to the address she provided, the place was unfurnished, like no one had been living there for a long time. Filling out number 7 slot is Billy Trimbach, Valentine's Day 1992. That day was the day Cindy and Billy Trimbach got married, and on their first anniversary, Billy was found shot to death 50 miles away from his home in Stoneham, Colorado. A police officer had actually driven by where his body was found earlier and saw multiple cars but didn't really think anything of it. Well, that should have told you that it was something shady, but okay, clearly not qualified. Evidence started pointing to Cindy, who had collected $500,000 in life insurance on his life, and things found in her car suggested his body had been inside of it. Cindy then moved to Montana with her 10-year-old son James, who she'd had from a previous marriage. But when a newspaper article came out about Billy's murder, James started getting teased about it by a fellow classmate. So the 10-year-old pulled out a gun and shot his classmate to death. He then went on to juvie, and Cindy died in 1996, and no one ever found out what happened to Billy. Now at number 6 is the reunion, Valentine's Day 2017. Now this one was shared by Redditor Queef of Police, which is hilarious by the way, who shared that he was deployed with US forces during Valentine's Day, so he unfortunately couldn't spend it with his wife. Either way, he sent her a sweet letter telling her he couldn't wait to see her, and when he finally came back, he found out that his wife was very much pregnant. The estimated conception date was Valentine's Day, and needless to say, the baby definitely wasn't his, and they definitely didn't stay married. That's shocking. These hoes ain't loyal, man. They never loyal. Coming in at number 5 is the St. Valentine's Day Massacre, Valentine's Day 1929. During this period, Al Capone's Southside gang was struggling to control organized crime in the city because they were up against an Irish Northsiders whose head was George Bugs Moran. That morning, 7 men from the Northsiders were gathered at Lincoln Park when they were lined up against a wall and shot by 4 unknown men that posed as police officers. It was assumed Al Capone was behind the whole thing because he wanted to get rid of Bugs, but he actually ended up being the last survivor of the North Northside gang. So I mean, that would have been a really crap day to take a Valentine's Day stroll through Linkin Park with your loved one. Just imagine seeing all those shootings. And I just realized Linkin Park isn't also the band Linkin Park. Yeah. At number four is Marcy Jo Andrews, Valentine's Day 1984. Marcy and her friends decide to go to a Valentine's Day party at a person called Casey Nowicki's apartment. Casey was driving Marcy and her two friends home when he crashed into a viaduct and Marcy's ankle got injured. In a moment of quick thinking, he told the girls to take his car keys and call a tow truck while he took Marcy to the hospital in a taxi. That night, the girls called Marcy, who was at Casey's apartment, sounding scared and saying he had never taken her to the hospital. That was the last time anyone heard from her ever again. Despite making many attempts to go to Casey's apartment, he kept telling the girls that Marcy had left ages ago and they had no idea where she was. In 2000, he was charged with murdering her as he had apparently drugged her with THC for days on end while he sexually abused her. A witness even claimed he had seen Marcy in his apartment days after the accident, naked and handcuffed to his radiator, apparently dead. Filling at number three slot is Maureen Fields, Valentine's Day 2006. 41-year-old Maureen Fields was in quite a bad place in her marriage with Paul Fields. When she went into work that day at the Wells Fargo Bank in Nevada, she told her co-workers that something was going to happen to her, and the next day she goes missing. Maureen's car ends up being found the next day stuck in the sand in a secluded section of the Mojave Desert. The only things left in the car were her purse, pantyhose, a blanket with vomit and blood on it, and an empty bottle of Xanax. And we've done enough cases to speculate the empty bottle meant suicide, but her body was never found. Male DNA was also found on her pantyhose, and in a plot twist, they did not match Paul. Instead, they matched convicted sex offender Keith Wayne Holmes, who said he had had consensual sex with Maureen before leaving her alone in the desert. An unlikely story. He also had dementia, so he couldn't really recall anything else, and we can't really verify his facts. Either way, her body was never found, so we don't really know what happened to her. Now at number two is Julie Valentine, Valentine's Day 1990. Glenn Haywood was looking for some wildflowers to give his wife that day when he decided to look in a field. That specific field was known as an illegal dumping ground, and so there was a bunch of random scattered everywhere, because apparently this was just a casual thing. Everyone was just dropping their illegal drugs and whatnot. Either way, Glenn ended up finding a Sears vacuum cleaner box which smelled like actual ass. You'd know. When he opened it, he found the decomposing body of a newborn baby girl. She was covered with some newspaper and a blanket, her umbilical cord was still attached, and the placenta was there as well. Autopsy reports confirmed she was most likely born 5 days before discovery and had died 2 days after being born. There was food in her stomach indicating that she had been looked after at one point or another, but then abandoned. They didn't know what to call her, but since she was found on Valentine's Day, they just dubbed her Julie Valentine. That's so sad. That is quite sad. And finally, at number one is Antonio Saldivar, Valentine's Day 2014. Houston-based 17-year-old Antonio borrowed his mom's car so he could go visit his girlfriend for the day. He had bought one of those huge teddy bears and wanted to go give it to her, but after missing his curfew, his mom started calling him. She finally got an answer from him at 4 a.m. when he called back saying, "Yeah, I know I'm grounded, but I'll be there. I'm coming, I'm on my way." And that was the last time anyone ever heard from Antonio again. Less than 30 minutes later, Antonio totaled the car by crashing into a concrete pillar, but his body wasn't found at the scene. Inside the car, authorities just found his shoes. He remained missing for another 2 weeks before his body was found underwater in the Houston Ship Channel. They assumed after the car accident he may have wandered around a bit disoriented and then drowned, but a lot of just doesn't add up. He never ended up going to his girlfriend's house, the teddy bear was found inside his pants, and the area he drowned in was inaccessible, so how did he even get there himself? Make it make sense. And that's it for today's video, guys. If you guys are feeling down that you're alone on Valentine's Day, do not worry. At least you are none of the 10 people on this list. There is that. We have our pros. Cons, pros, you know how it is. If you don't have a Valentine, I will be your Valentine. Happy Valentine's Day, you guys. How many times can I say this in this video? As always, I'm your host, Eamon Hassan, and I'll catch you in the next one. Bye. By the way, happy Valentine's Day. Plot twist, I think this is my first Valentine's Day I've spent alone in like 6 years. Someone just put crying emojis everywhere. 37-year-old Cassandra Randall, that's not her name. When he entered the house, he, why are you laughing? Do you laugh? Oh. So the 10-year-old pulled out a gun and shot, who the f*** is Jeremy? Oh, no! No, no, no. And shot by four, sorry. Linkin Park? Isn't that a band? what the f- kind of name is that,
dude?
But she went into work that day at the Wells Fargo. Okay.
What other people are trying to work here?
Was he bald?
No,
oh, I don't know if I said that right, but it sounded right. And finally, okay, and finally, don't smile.